Good morning. My name is Brittan Heller. I am counsel for business and human rights at Foley Hoag.
And I'm Ben Nimmo, and I'm director of investigations at Graphika, which is a New York social media analytics firm. It's a pleasure to be here at RSA. I come from Scotland, so it's a particular pleasure to be somewhere where the sun actually shines in February. And it's a special pleasure to be here because apparently I'm dead. I was declared dead by about 13,000 Russian Twitter bots back in August 2017. So I'd just like to take this point to say don't believe everything you read on the internet.
You know, Ben, that is a funny coincidence because I too am dead. I was not declared dead by Twitter bots. I was declared dead by some trolls who called into the local police department that I had been killed with an assault rifle, my non-existent children tied up, and fake pipe bombs put all over the neighborhood. So I too am dead.
And it's fun to look back on it. It's entertaining. But this is the kind of thing that people do to silence their critics. They try to silence the truth tellers. They try and silence the people who are revealing what's going on. So what we're going to talk about this morning is global trends in digital dictatorships. It's the dictatorial regimes, it's the groups that want to be dictatorial, how they work, what they do, and what we can do about it.
So I'm going to start by delineating three of these trends for you. I'm going to go into three specific examples so you can see what this looks like concretely. And then afterwards, Ben is going to go into some of the mechanics of how information operations work on a technical level. So 2019 is the year that everything hit the mainstream. Before that, coordinated disinformation campaigns were more of a tool that we saw in sophisticated statescraft. But based on the work of researchers like you, researchers like Ben, scholars and advocates like my colleagues, we all began to realize that this was more of a mainstream tactic. There are three things that digital authoritarians do. Governments around the world today are continuing to tighten up control over citizens' data and constraints on disinformation. And they do this to try to suppress dissent. This erodes trust both in the internet and in the foundations of democracy. So the three things we're going to talk about today are, first, digital authoritarians try to create domestic chaos and fear. And they do this by exacerbating pre-existing social fissures. Second, digital authoritarians attempt to silence voices and target influencers. And third, digital authoritarians opportunistically leverage or even warp the best efforts of people who are trying to promote human rights and freedom of expression. So first, let's talk about the direct intimidation of advocates, scholars, journalists, and minorities. We'll get into this example in a little more depth at the end, but I ended up a few years ago doing an AI-based project with UC Berkeley through the D-Lab. What we wanted to do was look at online hate speech and study the characteristics of it. How does it work? What are some of the ways that it operates differently than offline hate speech? And are there ways that we can study this so that we could try to mitigate it or understand it better? The focus group that we wanted to look at was anti-immigrant related hate speech leading up to the 2016 election. And we gave a group of Berkeley undergrads the worst summer job in the world. We gave them 10,000 Reddit comments and had them hand code them for a hate speech based rubric that we had developed. What came back was very, very surprising and not at all what we thought we were going to find, based on how offline hate speech and offline hate crimes work. I'll get into those findings a little more at the end, but the more interesting part for you is that after these findings were announced, a post showed up on the Daily Stormer. And this is a white nationalist and white supremacist website directing people specifically how to target me. They started with instructions to pose everything in terms of an opinion, so that it would be seen as legitimate political discourse and thus could not be taken down. They told people the legal definition of threatening speech and imminent threats, and told people to go right up to that line, no more, no less. They actually directed people what type of format to use in creating and sending these threats based on the platforms that were the most permissive of that type of content and had the most lax content moderation. So if you think that sometimes the intimidation of activists, scholars, minorities, and journalists just happens to be haphazard, that's no longer true. Let's go into a more specific example. A report released in October by the Republican-led Senate Intelligence Committee outlined how the Internet Research Agency, which is a troll farm operating out of St. Petersburg, as many people know, showed an overwhelming emphasis on race in the lead up to the 2016 presidential election. And this was especially true in posts that you saw on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. The intended goal of this operation was to demoralize and divide African American voters and to amplify racial tensions already present in US society. According to the report, about two-thirds of the Russian activity on social media was seeking to influence 2016 African American voters. And much of this activity focused on communities like Charlotte, North Carolina. Leading up to the election, there was the police shooting of Keith Lamont Scott, a resident of Charlotte. And more than a few people said that they were duped by Russian accounts in the social turmoil that rocked the city. The committee found that more than half of the IRA's most popular Instagram accounts targeted African-American issues and users explicitly. The most popular account was Blackstagram. It had 300,000 followers by the time it was detected. The IRA also bought Facebook advertisements under the accounts that you'll see here. Black Matters, which was another account, but Facebook pages like Blacktivist garnered millions of likes, shares, and comments. Part of the challenge with work like this is that it's very difficult to actually gauge the concrete impact on elections and democracies. But what we do know is that in 2016, African American voter turnout was 7% lower than it had been in the 2012 elections. And this was the largest such drop on record. It was even more stark in areas like North Carolina. Two, shutting down avenues of dissent in the name of quelling online harms. A report came out yesterday from an internet freedom NGO called Access Now, and it talks about how internet shutdowns are now a commonplace tool of digital authoritarians, especially in the lead up to elections and in periods of social unrest. A lot of my work looks at this phenomenon in areas across the world, especially in the global south. So, for example, the governments of the Democratic Republic of the Congo, the Gambia, Sierra Leone, have all shut down the internet during their elections. Chad has had a social media shutdown lasting 1 year. This is because the government claims that Facebook, Twitter, and WhatsApp are helping to organize anti-government protests that threaten their internal security. Other countries have restricted the internet to curb protests, and these include Ethiopia, Cameroon, Zimbabwe, Sudan, Algeria, Togo, and Gabon. But this is a phenomenon that is actually not limited to the global south. It spreads throughout the world, every country. And you can see this in some of the reporting that comes from companies like Facebook about all of the operations that they take down. Freedom House issues a report about the freedom of the net. When that report was released in January 2019, that same week, there were internet disruptions in Sudan, Ethiopia, Algeria, Venezuela, Liberia, and Kazakhstan. Related to this, and since I'm a lawyer, I find this to be very interesting, you see legislative efforts around the world to try to curb disinformation, misinformation, and fake news. Smart regulation around this area is not a bad thing. However, it needs to focus on behaviors instead of actors and content in order to be pro-freedom of expression. The bigger challenge is that the same law, the same exact text, copied and pasted from one national context to another, will have fundamentally different results based on the human rights record and the democratic vulnerabilities in the country where it operates. There were 17 such laws that were proposed around the world in 2018. And if you think about it, the same law in Singapore will look different implemented in Russia, will look different implemented in the United States, and will look different implemented in Germany. A lot of times, digital authoritarians will point to the fact that it is the same exact text and try to use that as gloss to pretend like they are in support of freedom of expression and other fundamental human rights. I spent time in Uganda this year. So our deep dive is going to be the experience I had studying the impact of disinformation and hate speech on the 2016 elections in Uganda. Many people don't pay attention to what happens there, but there were hundreds of people who were the victims of violence and social media instigated deaths. When you look at Uganda, it's actually like a maelstrom of all of these different malign activities on the internet. There's no law against hate speech per se, but there is a law against disinformation. It is very loosely worded, and that was used to quell dissent against the government. During the election, President Museveni shut down the internet for 4 days without warning. And the explanation was that the shutdown was a preventative measure to address security threats, to stem misinformation and rumors, and prevent the illegal continuation of campaigning throughout the election. The funny thing was, people who studied this afterwards found that the Ugandan government was actually continuing to post during the shutdown, but it was the opposition parties who were not allowed to post. The opposition candidate who had the strongest showing was named Bobby Wine. And in one of his last postings, he told people about VPNs and how to use them. This is a chart from the Tor project, which at the very end shows you how people, how VPN use jumped after the internet shutdown. So this is still an area that researchers need to look at to see the impact it's actually having on elections, or if populations are using different ways to subvert it. The type of information that governments were trying, that the Museveni government was trying to quell is kind of exemplified by this tweet and the hashtag 1986 pictures. Museveni has been in power for 30 years. So opponents of the Museveni regime started putting up pictures from 1986 to try to show how different things are now than they were when Museveni first came into power. So this voter is emphasizing that he was 2 years old when Museveni took power, and he is now 31. Those are the type of things that they didn't want people posting on Twitter. Finally, we have the use of hate speech and online harassment to target minority groups. This is something very dear to my heart. Trolling is the vocabulary used by digital authoritarians. And there's a very specific reason for this. The vectors of disinformation and misinformation are often intertwined with hate speech and harassment. This is how offline phenomenon move into online spaces. The reason that this is effective and the reason that this has become a commonplace thing is because tech companies are notoriously remiss in dealing with online harassment. This is a structural, a technical, and a policy hole in company policies. And what this does is create a fertile breeding ground for testing out new ways to manipulate people. If you look at reports coming out of the Institute for the Future, last year they detailed how 10 different minority groups were targeted by disinformation. The Oxford Internet Institute did a similar report looking at gender. So going back to the example I started with the D-Lab at Berkeley, we were trying to look at xenophobic hate speech. This word cloud shows you what came back. So the top five hits were Jew, black, white, woman, and hate, in that order. That is not what we expected when we were trying to find anti-immigrant related animus. We also found that some of the other indicators that hate speech would be present were people who looked like they were attempting to engage in civil debate, sea lioning and things like that, attempting to engage someone in debate and peppering them with so many questions that they actually shut them down and then were able to reflexively say, well, I'm the one trying to actually talk to you. You're the one not being civil. So this was one of the first indicators to me as a researcher that something was rotten in the state of Berkeley?
California?
Yeah. So, and as I described, after this, there were many researchers on the project who were very afraid of online harassment and did not want to be identified, and we took steps to anonymize their participation. As the face of the project, I ended up getting targeted by white supremacists and white harassment, white nationalist groups, which we think might have contributed to the swatting that happened last year, which declared me dead. So, on that happy note, I'm going to turn it over to Ben Nimmo to describe to you in more lurid technical detail how this actually works.
Thank you. Okay, I will try to be lurid to the extent that we're allowed to on a Friday morning. So Britain's given you the overall idea of what the digital authoritarians and the would-be dictators are trying to do. They're trying to shut us down, they're trying to stifle criticism, they're trying to kill off debate. What I will talk about is a little bit more of the fine grain of how they actually shape the message, how we can all predict the message, how to disrupt it, and how all of us can actually play our role. The internet is a big place. We need more eyeballs on it. We need more people actually involved in this business. And so what I will do is talk a little bit through the kind of patterns that you can look for and the kind of patterns that when you explain to people will help to disrupt what's going on. So first of all, disinformation. Disinformation is a buzzword at the moment. Disinformation, misinformation, fake news, confusing concepts. If you look at the way some of the digital authoritarians around the world operate, there's a very consistent pattern by which they behave. And I think of it as the four D's of disinformation. It's dismiss, distort, distract, and dismay. And for pretty well any kind of criticism that gets leveled at one of these would-be authoritarians, they will come out with one of the four responses. And you can actually use this as a model. You can use this to predict what's going to come next. So dismiss is the simplest one. You insult the witness so that people won't actually look at the evidence. Really, really common tactic by dictators across the globe. One of my favorite examples, this is a post from the Russian embassy in South Africa. If you remember in 2017, Morgan Freeman fronted a video saying that, yes, Russia has attacked the United States. This is a meme posted by the Russian embassy. Note that this is a verified account. And it's using the hashtag StopMorganLie, which was launched by the Russian troll farm. But what it says is that the famous Hollywood actor Morgan Freeman is happy to tell tall tales about Russian interference. He's also happy to talk about his devotion to marijuana. And then the punchline, is it worth listening? That punchline is the dismiss tactic right in one sentence. Don't listen to him, don't listen to anything he says because sometimes he smokes dope, right? They're trying to trash the witness without having the evidence looked at. And particularly with Russian operations, if you see somebody accused of being a Russophobe or a neocon or a fascist, it's all about silencing the witness without the evidence being looked at. So that's the dismiss tactic. That's the most common one. Distort. if the facts go against you, make up your own facts. Alternative facts. Who remembers the phrase alternative facts? Yeah? That's D2, that's distort. This was the largest audience to ever witness an inauguration, period. Sean Spicer, 2017. Trump inauguration pictures were edited after he intervened. The Guardian, 2018. If you don't like the evidence, cook up your own. And again, we've seen many different would-be authoritarians around the world using D2. Distort the facts if you don't like the real ones. D3, distract. If you're accused of something, accuse somebody else of the same thing. Back in the days of the Cold War, this was called whataboutism. Well, so what if we're cluster bombing one country? You used to cluster bomb Vietnam. And I've seen that argument over Libya and over Syria. Well, you did it to Vietnam. Well, it's like, this is relevant how exactly? China gets criticized for its human rights record, understandably. So a statement from the Chinese foreign ministry, the US continues to point fingers at the human rights conditions of more than 190 countries while turning a deaf ear to its own grave human rights problems. Because I'm sure we would all agree that the kind of abuse that's being leveled at the Uyghurs right now with the massive internment camps in Xinjiang is entirely equivalent to human rights issues in the United States, right? Draw a false equivalency. It's not actually about making a legitimate claim. It's about changing the subject. Because now we're not talking about what's going on in China. We're talking about what the US is doing. We're having the wrong argument. So D3 is distract, change the subject. And the D4, if all else fails, just scare them off. If you keep on doing this, something horrible will happen. Literally, you can go nuclear with the rhetoric. So in, I think, 2015, Denmark was talking about contributing one radar frigate to NATO's missile ballistic missile defense system. Okay, one radar frigate. We're not talking shooters, we're just talking a radar. The Russian ambassador to Denmark gave an interview with Jyllands-Posten, the biggest newspaper in Denmark, saying, well, of course, if you do that, we'll have to put you on the nuclear strike list. It's like it's going nuclear in a rhetorical sense. In the same way, if after the Assad regime launched its sarin attack in Khan Sheikhoun in 2017 in Syria, part of the rhetoric from the Kremlin and the pro-Assad side was, but if you do anything, this will cause World War III. It's putting out threats which are so lurid, to come to Britain's point, that it scares people off. So dismiss, distort, distract, and dismay are the four techniques that to watch out for from these would-be authoritarians. And you can play bingo with them. If you ever feel inclined to watch Vladimir Putin's three-hour televised marathon press conference each year, take the list of the four Ds with you and tick them off as they come through. See how many you can get. It makes it otherwise a very painful experience, quite a lot more entertaining. So that's what they do. That's the way the message is shaped. The question is then, how do they get the message out there? It's fine for a government to make up a message of evil intent. How do you get it in front of real people? And there's been a lot of talk over the last couple of years about Russian bots and Russian trolls and all the kind of social media interference that we see. But you always have to remember that actually the social media aspect is only one small slice of a full spectrum of information operations. And certainly when you're looking at the state-backed actors, they have access to the full spectrum. So you have everything from hackers, genuine hackers, fake hacktivists, you have government officials, state mouthpieces, covert media outlets, which are state-sponsored but claim not to be, troll farms, internet research agency, and they have willing supporters, real people who believe this stuff and want to amplify it. And when you see a sophisticated state actor working, you'll see all these different things brought together. The example I'm going to give is the hacking of the World Anti-Doping Agency, WADA, in 2016. One minute of context. So in early 2016, WADA comes out with a statement saying, we have found massive state-sponsored doping by the Russian state. Big, big, big scandal. Okay? But if you think about it, this is not a security threat to the Russian nation. This is not a military issue. This is a political embarrassment for the Putin government because they've made part of their prestige is about rebuilding the glory of Russian sport, right? So this is not a military security threat in any sense of the word. And yet, the response by the Russian government is to deploy these guys. For those of you who don't recognize this picture, this is an elite hacking team from Russian military intelligence who were sent off on a jolly trip around the world, including to Rio de Janeiro, to go and hack into WADA and the International Olympic Committee. Think about that for a second. You've had a political embarrassment, so you're turning the military intelligence hackers loose on an international organization. That tells you quite a lot about the way politics is working in Russia at the moment. This photo is actually from 2018, when the same guys were sent to hack the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons in The Hague, and rather embarrassingly got caught in the act. The Dutch have done a wonderful briefing on this. It's well worth reading, not least because you even have the hackers kept their receipts from, like, Russian military intelligence HQ to the airport for the taxi, because, you know, even spies these days have to get their expenses docketed, right? So these guys are deployed. They hack the IOC and they hack WADA. The next step is that this anonymous hacktivist community called the Fancy Bears Hack Team pops up online, and they start pushing out leaked documents that the GRU, that military intelligence, have hacked, showing that Western athletes had therapeutic use exemptions. Now, therapeutic use exemptions are legitimate, right? The doctor says, you need this drug, which would normally be banned, but you need it for medical reasons. There are questions as to how transparent the process is, but these are entirely legitimate use cases. What happens is the Fancy Bears hack team push these out and say, it's not just Russia which is doping. Everybody's doping. The West is doping too. You think about the 4Ds, that's D3, right? Distract. You accuse us of doing that, we accuse you of doing that. So this is Russian military intelligence hackers now posting this stuff on social media. They were also reaching out directly to journalists. They were messaging real journalists and saying, hey, we've got a sensational story for you. So for the journalists in the room, bear in mind, we already have cases where you have been direct targets of information operations. I would bet that you're going to get that again in 2020. Somebody's going to reach out and try and plant stories in front of journalists, so be aware. But you also have another Russian embassy. Russia has some very, very trolley kind of embassies. The UK Russian embassy, look, 25 athletes use doping, only one Russian, but five Brits and 10 Americans. That's D3 again. Distract. You accuse us, we accuse you. And they're focusing on the word hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is kind of the classic distraction word. It's coming from the embassy. It's also coming from Sputnik, which is a state mouthpiece. Sputnik claims to be editorially independent. If you read the founding charter of the company which owns Sputnik, the Russia Svobodnaya News Agency, it says one of their jobs is to secure the national interests of the Russian Federation in the information sphere. Independent? Open to question. But look, their story is talking about the leaked documents exposed to the US athletes. Hypocrisy. There's that same buzzword again. And interestingly, if you look at the top right, I searched for the word hypocrisy. The article itself is based on an interview. Nowhere in the interview did the interviewee use the word hypocrisy. But Sputnik have headlined it anyway. What does that tell you about what's going on? Another one here. So here's a story. Hackers have exposed that the US Olympic champions are based on doping. Same story again, right? Hypocrisy. This is an outlet called Bolt News, which operates in the Baltic states. It claims to be independent, but some very good investigative journalists in Latvia have proven that it's funded through a series of shell companies by the Russia Svobodnaya News Agency, which also funds Sputnik. So this claims to be independent, but in fact, it's funded by, ultimately, the Russian state, okay? So we've gone from the overt side, diplomats, Sputnik. We're going to the covert side. At the same time, you have troll farms. This is a piece on Medium I found not long ago. Doping vs. money, who wins? It's all about the corruption which is at the heart of the IOC and WADA, and how all this doping is really is just about the West defending its monetary interests. What's interesting is the byline, because this is by a lady called Jenna Abrams. For those of you who are aficionados of the original Russian troll farm, Jenna Abrams was one of their most effective personas. She got quoted all over the place. Very effective troll account, a lot of style, very snarky, got picked up a lot. But this is Jenna Abrams on Medium, so the Russian troll farm, the IRA, amplifying the same message that you've already had from the diplomats and the overt sites, yeah? We're seeing the full spectrum in operation here. And then this is where it gets really tricky. I've obscured the name of this post, of this tweeter, because this is a real person. There is no indication at all that this person is anything to do with any Russian information operation, but they believe the same story. They've fallen for it, they've taken the bait, they are now spreading it abroad. And this is where so much of our work gets challenging, because we're looking not just at the bad actors who are trying to seed their content, But we're also looking at the people who are then picking it up and spreading it entirely in good faith, as far as we can tell. And for all of us looking at this space, one of the key questions is, okay, and this is why we focus on behavior a lot more than just content, because if you're looking at the content, you'd think, well, it's talking about hypocrisy, it must be part of the operation. It's like, well, no, looking at all the other behavior, looking at the actor, that's somebody who has just fallen for the message. And so that's why we have to be so very, very careful in this space, particularly when we're looking at content clues. And so really, what you've got here is the level of sophistication that we are looking at. You've got everything from hackers from military intelligence through diplomatic missions. You even had Vladimir Putin in person accusing the West of hypocrisy. And then it cascades down. You get the same pickup by state outlets, covert outlets, the troll farm, individual troll accounts, and then it gets picked up by real people. This is far more than just a bunch of Russian bots posting stuff online. This example is from Russia, but there are many, many examples from many countries around the world doing similar things. Iran has been very active in the disinfo space. We've seen China getting into the disinfo space more. Saudi Arabia, a lot going on in the Gulf region generally. These are sophisticated actors. There are many different parts of the puzzle, but that also means there are many different things that we can pull at to try and work out how this all fits together. The more actors you have, the more potential leads you have. So the question is, what can we do about it? What can we act on? What can we take away from this session?
Well, I think there's three things when you're looking at global trends that the cybersecurity community in particular can take to heart and try to do to be proactive about this. First, use human rights concerns to inform a risk-based allocation of your resources. The thing that I hear from clients and companies all the time is that they just feel ill-equipped to handle this because these are countries from all over the world, these are massive in scale, and what do you expect one company to do about it? What I expect one company to do about it is to treat this like you treat other security threats, to basically determine what areas of the world are going to be targeted, and oftentimes we see elections and civil unrest being the red flag that shows that there's a vulnerability here, to devote your resources, your staff, and your attention to that, and to respond accordingly. So just because something is a disinformation or information operation or a human rights-based threat, I don't think you should treat it differently than you would any other threat to your operational security. Second is commit to independent human rights impact assessments. This is something that hasn't really hit the cybersecurity community yet. It is just starting to hit the rest of the tech industry, but it is well established. The UN Guiding Principles for Business and Human Rights are something that the cybersecurity community can look to try to figure out how governments can protect human rights, but companies respect human rights, and the sort of policies, procedures, and standards that you can use to try to do this. This is a picture that represents the first human rights impact assessment that was publicly released by Facebook. They did an assessment about the impact that their platform was having in Myanmar on the genocide of the Rohingya. If you do human rights impact assessments, the benefit to your cybersecurity company will be that you will have feedback loops that you otherwise wouldn't have. And you'll be able to anticipate risks and see problems before they get to that point. Relatedly, the final thing is move beyond product patches to systemic approaches. If you wait until you figure out that you've had an information operation or something that impacts the fundamental human rights of your users, customers, and consumers, it is already too late. So thinking about these things in your product development timelines and thinking about it at the very beginning of your user experience and how to get feedback from your most vulnerable users to your engineers and designers is something that you can do. So don't just be a triage team. Actually think about it more like, more in a preventative sense.
And my 3 points to finish off with, I mean, firstly, take photos of dolphins. Anytime you're taking photos of dolphins, you're doing something far more valuable for yourself and everybody else than all the stuff we do, because dolphins are cool. But more to the point, the first thing we need is just attention. And we need the kind of careful and thoughtful attention that helps people to think, okay, information operations and influence operations are a real thing. They are potentially dangerous. They could target all of us. But actually, we don't want to panic here. We don't want to run around saying, oh my God, everything's a Russian bot, because it's not. About maybe 5% of the queries I get of people saying, hey, I think I found a Russian bot, might actually turn out to be a Russian bot as opposed to something completely unrelated. So it's getting more and more people to look at this problem, but to look at it through the lens of the 4Ds. Look at what the bad actors are doing, break it down, try and understand it, try and explain it to people. This is not just a splurge of terrifying disinformation. It follows a pattern. It's repetitive. It's predictable. I remember back in 2015, 16, there was so much Russian disinformation coming out that at some point, those of us who were kind of specialists in this field were just sitting there holding our heads in our hands and saying, my God, this is so predictable. Did you hear what Lavrov just said? He said it a million times before. And you think, yeah, actually, it is predictable. It does follow a pattern. And you can disrupt it. And the more people we have looking at the problem and paying attention to it and breaking it down into its component parts, the stronger we will collectively be. The second thing, attribution. The biggest challenge in this space, or one of the biggest challenges, is actually attributing operations to a specific actor, or to be able to say reliably, yes, this comes from a specific country. Like I said, probably 95% of the claims I see of Russian bots have nothing to do with Russia and probably have nothing to do with being bots. The phrase is out there, people have kind of heard of it but don't really get how it works. If anybody can think of more technical ways in which we can advance our ability to attribute, then please do. Because there are all kind of clues out there. Open source, you can do amazing things. I will always treasure the day that I found a bilingual pro-Kremlin propaganda website which just happened to have been registered to the finance department of the Far Eastern Military District of the Russian Federation. Because they'd kind of forgotten to do the whole like privacy-protected whois registration. You know, you get slam dunks like that. It does happen. That's open source for you. You find people who kind of slip up and they leave their, you know, they leave their actual account. They post, it looks like they're running several different accounts from TweetDeck or Hootsuite or something, and they post the wrong thing from the wrong account, and you think, you really didn't want to do that. So there are ways we can all work on attribution, but the more thinking we can do collectively, how can you reliably prove that the thing you are looking at is actually part of an operation, and where that operation comes from is crucial. Because we've all seen news reports where we think it's the Russians because it's posting about the Gilets Jaunes movement in France. It's like, well, yeah, but kind of French people do that too. So we do need to have any bright ideas out there about how to improve attribution are worth gold at this point. And the final one is amplification. Tell people about this. Things like the 4Ds are a really simple thing to carry around and remember and to explain to people. I can't do complicated stuff, so I do the simple things, right? The 4Ds, you can use them. You can use them to break down a Vladimir Putin press conference. Pick a world leader of your choice. Try them out. Explain to people very simple tactics, just like if you can reverse search a profile picture, then you can show people how to do that. Then the next time they see a social media account that they've not seen before, reverse search it. Is it a real person or is it a stock photo which has cropped up on 100,000 different accounts? There are very simple techniques that we can pass on to people, but it's getting people to understand that ultimately, you know, the day you're told that you're dead, weirdly, it's not scary for you because you kind of know they're wrong. But it's your friends who are getting worried, who get scared. So it's how do you reach your friends and tell them, no, actually, this is just another troll attack. Here's how it works. Here's how you break it down. And here's how what you make the inexplicable explainable. And once you've done that, we're already a long way towards solving the problem. So with that,
so long,
so long and thanks for all the fish. We couldn't resist it. Do we have questions?
Yes, we have about 10 minutes for questions if anybody has them.
We do.
And we got a chuckle at our joke.
We did. Well, your joke. Your joke. Ladies first.
Hi, I don't know if I'm short, so I don't know if you can hear me. I am Kemba. I am legal counsel to Microsoft's Defending Democracy program. And I spend a lot of time, I spend a lot of time thinking about the legal challenges to controlling disinformation. Mm-hmm. And you'd mentioned, helpfully, that regulatory control should focus on behavior and not necessarily content moderation. And I think about it in the election security context. What behaviors would you recommend for that would help thread the First Amendment needle when challenging disinformation defense?
That is a really specific question.
I'm so sorry.
No, it's okay. So I think we should talk afterwards because that could be a whole nother book. Thank you. What I would do is actually look at the exceptions to the First Amendment and some of those are pretty easy, you know, like imminent threats, like and anything around the fomentation of violence gets you out of the freedom of expression box. Since the Defending Democracy Project is also a global project, I hate doing this, but I'm going to do it anyway. I wrote a paper. there's a paper that I published with some colleagues at the Transatlantic Working Group, which is a primer on freedom of expression and the similarities and differences between the US, the European, and the EU regimes. And it actually lays out globally what we have in common when we're looking at this human right. And so that's probably a really good place to start. I'll take your colleague behind since he was waiting first, and then.
Cool. Hi. I'm Dave. I work for a consulting firm in DC. I think this is a question probably more for Ben Nimmo. The couple examples you showed of different Russian embassy posts, one of them seemed to be in sort of the host country language, and one of them seemed to be in Russian. I don't speak Russian, but it's Cyrillic at any rate. To what extent are they using their embassy postings, posting via their embassy verified Twitter accounts or other social accounts as a domestic regime stabilization mechanism to sort of point inwards at Russian audiences that are reading it versus to what extent is it outward facing? And do you see anything interesting about sort of the way those behaviors might differ?
That's a really great question. So in that case, the Morgan Freeman one particularly, that was a hashtag which was, it looked like it was primarily aimed at Russian audiences to start with. It kicked off with a particular group within the Internet Research Agency called Agitprop, which is like the Agitation Regiment, which was primarily Russian language. And they came out with various hashtag campaigns like Happy Birthday, Mr. President, and Happy Birthday, Sergei Shoigu, right? I mean, it was pretty clunky stuff. That was a case where the early traffic was in Russian, and then they started using primarily Russian language accounts to post in English as well. So that was a somewhat weird one. And then in like the second and third iterations, you had outlets like RT, Russia Today, doing a I think their headline was Morgan Freeman video backfires and people are outraged. I think if you interpret people as not very many people, you'd get a lot closer, right? So that was an interesting one where it started off as domestic, but then they tried to spin it as a foreign one, using their foreign assets to point to it and say, look, it's getting lots of traction. The one on hypocrisy, so the Russian embassy in London does a lot of trolling of the UK government, so that's much more focused at the UK political scene. So there's a little bit of both, but in general, the ultimate purpose seems to be more targeting a foreign audience. But sometimes they'll try and build up a head of steam in Russian first and then flip it outwards.
Yeah, some other researchers in the space have been pointing out that they are seeing a bifurcation of techniques, where the IRA is focusing more on traditional trolling, and the GRU and other entities are focusing more on fake think tanks and other things that have a gloss of respectability and trying to.
I'm not sure I actually agree with the analysis that those are different. I think that one is just a more sophisticated type of trolling. Apologies to some of the think tank people in the room. But we have noticed a sort of a diversification of techniques. So it's not just angry Twitter posts anymore.
Thank you.
Sir.
My name is Don Hudson. I'm a journalist. I was fascinated with your slides about the protests in Charlotte, specifically because I live there. And, you know, the story we were hearing was that African Americans, you know, groups were laying to be ready to come into Charlotte and looking for like a reason to get ignited to come for the protests. And then somebody was shot that night, you know, in the middle of the protests over the other guy that was shot. And I haven't seen the explanation that the Russians were behind and what were, so can you tell me what they were behind and how did they play into it and what were they trying, what was the outcome they were trying to?
And you've looked at a lot of this too. So basically what the intent behind it was to take the pre-existing social conditions in Charlotte and
which was unknown largely mm-hmm. in the mass, but go ahead.
And sort of amplify the pre-existing racial tensions. So leveraging the death of that gentleman and using that to try to get people upset about police brutality in general, and then spinning it down and down and down to more community-focused events. So
Something we saw a few times in 2016 was the IRA, so the Russian IRA, the Internet Research Agency, would actually organize events where they'd be putting either one American group or two American groups on the streets at the same time and trying to get them to go head to head. The classic example is on the 21st of May 2016, the Troll Farm organized a protest in Houston, Texas against an Islamic cultural center and a simultaneous counter demonstration in favor of the cultural center, same time, same place. And the Facebook ad they posted said, you know, bring your arms, concealed or not. And journalists on the ground at the time reported there was at least one guy with an AR-15 on his shoulder. Now, nobody got hurt. Nobody, you know, thankfully the sense of the American people was enough not to start shooting at each other. But it looks like at least part of the Troll Farm tactic was to put Americans on the ground in harm's way and even tell them to bring their guns. So it looks like that one of their broader efforts was aimed at getting angry Americans to face off in the streets, not just on Twitter.
Now, was Charlottesville also, did that apply to Charlottesville as well? Did they get involved in that?
I would need to dig in the records. That was one of the posts from Black Matters. I think Charlottesville was August 2017. Mm-hmm. So that was around the time the first generation of IRA accounts were being taken down. So I'd need to dig back and find what they were posting around that point.
And you said Charlottesville, not Charlotte.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
For fun, Charlotte's going to host the RNC this summer, so it should be entertaining.
We should touch base on that after. I think we got like two more minutes. So I think we got one more question.
Just curious your thoughts. I think, you know, the social media platforms obviously have some responsibility for helping to combat this, but your thoughts on what government could or shouldn't do in addressing this disinformation specifically, you know, aimed at harming democracy and things like that. I know the military has talked about information operations being part of the greater, you know, cyber fight, and just curious your thoughts on that.
I think helping citizens develop resiliency is actually one of the better things that we can do. When you look at the demographics of people who spread most of this information, it is a very concrete slice of people. I don't want to say okay, boomer, but I will. So they're actually, if you look around the world, some of the most successful efforts have actually been in Scandinavia, where they have faced Russian disinformation operations for decades. And so people have more of an inherent skepticism of how these things work and what they read on the internet, but they have really great civic education programs as well that focus on younger people and older people. I think there was some coverage in the New York Times over the last day or two about how Older people are now starting to get education, and this has been proven to be one of the few things that actually has an impact on combating the effects of disinformation.
Mm-hmm. And just the one thing I'd add to that, just to finish off that middle slide, add attribution. The different actors can do different parts on this, right? We can, you know, open source, we can find the website with the weird registration. Platforms can find the stuff on their end. There are sorts of information available to government and to the authorities which guys like us cannot get hold of. Sometimes that can be very useful on the attribution side. And it's akin to cyber, right? So one concrete thing would be to see more effort putting into the attribution side of this. What can be done to work out where this is coming from? Because it's only when you know who's behind it that you can actually start thinking of deterrence. And ultimately, moving towards deterrence would be the logical step.
Yeah, and I think earlier this week, Facebook announced a large sum of money for information or for research focusing on disinformation. So having researchers take advantage of those opportunities and press platforms to make more information available to researchers would be a good step as well.
And we are now out of time. So thank you all very much. If anybody needs to talk, we'll be outside.